Hello there, with the launch of patch 2.25 we got a cool new feature, which is follower dungeons. While these probably aren't super interesting for players who regularly do group content endgame, they are after all a lot slower to do and only available in normal difficulty, which gives pretty much worse loot than any other alternative out there. I think it's also fair to say that this is a technology that isn't really aimed at those of us who do play that content. It's often said that there's a silent majority of casual players out there that don't really engage much with the three pillars of endgame, and while there's sources of data out there that we can use to get a good idea of raid and mythic plus participation, the actual player numbers who don't do those three pillars can be a bit of a mystery. Now, the closest source we have is probably the site data for Azeroth, and I'm going to put a link in the description below for that. This gives info about the proportion of accounts which have certain achievements. Now, I think as I understand it, data for Azeroth does have to guess which characters are in what account, and I suspect they're also having to make guesses about what accounts and what characters are active, so this won't be 100% reliable, but I think as long as we apply a suitable level of caution to the data we're looking at here, there is some interesting info we can glean. Now, the Dungeon Halls of Infusion was completed by 68% of players, but only 35% of players have completed the Vault of Incarnate raid. Now, that's the first raid of the expansion, and generally we believe that participation is a lot higher at the start of an expansion, so this is probably potentially a good measure of overall raid participation. Now, one thing we do need to keep in mind with the Vault of Incarnate number is it doesn't measure the number of people who don't complete the raid, it's just the ones who do it completely. But even without that, I think that's telling us that probably about a third of the player base don't do dungeons at all, and somewhere up to 2/3 of the player base don't manage to complete the raid. Now, which tells us that there's a very large chunk of players that probably aren't actively playing what we would consider to be the PvP endgame. Now, I do think we need to be mindful there'll probably be PvP players as well in those groups, people who only PvP, so it does make it quite hard to kind of figure out how many people don't do the third pillars, but my guess is that we're probably landing somewhere around 50% of the player base who are not routinely doing that content. Now, it's that 50% who don't do the endgame content that I think follower dungeons are aimed at catering to. It's now possible for players who don't do group content to do dungeons, albeit at a lower level. And I suspect that if this feature carries forward, we're actually going to see the number of people who do the normal dungeons drop slightly, as some of the folks who would prefer to only play solo, but who currently do the dungeons just for the quest, will switch over to the new feature. Now, there are always going to be players who don't want to group up, or indeed just find that the gameplay for them is better outside of a group, but I also have a feeling that this in the longer term could work in a similar way to LFR, where it becomes a training ground or almost kind of like a lead-in for the group content. For example, I started playing WoW back at the end of Legion, and I started out pretty much just playing fully solo. I just did quests. Eventually I did start to dip into queuing for dungeons to get some extra XP, but once I hit max level in Legion, and you want to keep in mind at this time Antorus had been open for many months, so it was actually very, very hard to jump into content that, you know, players and groups just expected you to know. So all I really did in Legion was I dipped into LFR, particularly the last wing in LFR, because it gave relatively good gear compared to other sources. But at that stage for me, you know, the idea of finding a guild or joining pre-made groups just wasn't really on my agenda. Now, moving into early BFA, my plan at the start of BFA had been to just do the dungeons and LFR. But thanks to the relatively more generous gearing we had in BFA, especially looking at you Warfronts, after like just 1 week of LFR, I realised I was already in a place where I couldn't get any upgrades from it, and that's what actually made me to dip decide to dip into normal raids. But the thing is, the reason I had the confidence to try that was because of LFR. It was because I'd seen the content, because I'd had some experience of at least playing with groups. It was that that kind of bolstered me up to the point where I'd be willing to put myself out there and sign up for those pre-mades, you know. Especially given, you know, a lot of the stories you hear as a new player is that they're really hard to get into and they can be a bit of toxic, which incidentally, if you are a solo player, that was very much the opposite. If you join these types of groups right at the start of a new raid, I find that for the first couple of weeks they're actually super chill. It's later on, once people start to learn the content, that the kind of expectations and intolerance of new players kicks in. But anyway, I digress. Now, I fully expect that with Follow Dungeons, some people are actually going to come in and, you know, once they've seen the inside of dungeons, that'll maybe give them a bit of confidence or even the curiosity to encourage them to try to queue up for dungeons that they haven't done before. And this idea of a training ground, I think, is a major selling point for this feature. I mean, for example, right now, if you've ever thought about tanking but found it a bit mysterious, intimidating, and kind of like if you don't have any friends who would let you tank for them to try it, you know, I think it can be something to get very hard to get into. Now, I will tell you that tanking's neither mysterious nor intimidating. I mean, I personally do it, and if I can do it, honestly, anyone can. But I do think that with these follower dungeons, it's going to be creating a bit of a safe space where somebody says, well, we'll be able to say, go in and say, I'll try and tank the dungeon, I'll try and heal the dungeon with NPCs who are not going to get angry at me before I try to do groups. And I also think that, you know, that will probably benefit group oriented players as well. I'm sure everybody who's pugged like a dungeon at some point will have had that healer who just doesn't heal, or the tank who just doesn't taunt or have any aggro. And you know, perhaps for those players, being able to practice a little bit before they join groups could even make our experience when we have them come into our groups for the first time be a little bit more positive. Now, I've tried a few follower dungeons at the moment, and I do think that Blizzard seem to have leaned very hard into the learning aspect. I've noticed that the NPCs that come along in the dungeon actually do give some useful tips. For example, on the second last boss for Ruby Life Pool, when the big circles that you have to run out of appear, one of the NPCs will actually say, we should move out of those, for example. But honestly, for me, that's not the true major feature. You know, even though I do Mythic Plus and a raid, and I'm pretty comfortable in groups, and I actually pug it quite a bit as well, so I'm even comfortable in pugs. Assuming this feature's available at the start of the War Within, honestly, my first runs through the new dungeons are going to be likely to be using these systems, even though it's going to be solo. And why would I do that? Well, pretty much since the Burning Crusade, Blizzard have been trying to tie the dungeons into the story flow of zones. Now, initially it would be like the odd dungeon here and there, like, you know, the dungeons down in Cogflying Reservoir and Burning Crusade, or the Deep Mines and Cataclysm. But these days, and I think especially since BFA, pretty much every leveling zone has a dungeon as a capstone, as Blizzard are really leaning harder and harder into trying to integrate them into the storylines. Now, the problem with doing this is that even for a super engaged lore player like myself, group content just isn't a good vehicle for story. You know, when I pick up the quest in a zone to do the dungeon, sure, I'll queue up and I'll do it, but I play no attention at all to the story inside. And this isn't just an issue with WoW. Well, back when I did the MSQ in Final Fantasy XIV, which is known for how hard it leans into its story, it was exactly the same. The truth is that the combination of having to keep up with a group, many of whom just have different goals to me, like they're not interested in the story, and, you know, the social pressure that I feel that I don't want to spoil their gameplay by making them stand about while I look through cinematics or like gawk at the scenery. The truth is, Group content just disincentivizes paying attention to the NPC dialogue or story that goes through the dungeon. Now, Final Fantasy, of course, introduced the trust system in Shadowbringers, and I remember when I got up to that expansion and I did my first trust dungeon, the first thing I noticed was how much it felt more like the part of the story. You know, I'm going into this dungeon and I'm continuing the story. And this is, I think, why I'd be really keen to be using this system at launch. Now, one of the cool things about the trust system is that the NPCs that you recruit from an MSQ dungeon are basically the NPCs that you were doing the story with at that point. Currently, of course, the WoW Fallout dungeon is just using the Exile's Reach NPCs. I suspect that's partly because the Fallout tech they'd already been using a little bit in the old Exile's Reach dungeon back from when they released it, and there's probably a lot of coding in the game for these NPCs that they could reuse. But I'm hoping that in future, as they move on into doing the other expansions, they'll rotate and expand the pull out of NPCs to try and make it a bit more sense. You know, these particular NPCs, they're good kind of random people to jump into a dungeon at endgame when you're done with the story. But, you know, if you kind of come to the bit, you know, in the Azure Span where you say, go clear out the Brackenhide Hollow, and all of a sudden you've got this bunch of guys that you only spoke to right at the start of the first zone of Dragonflight, it'd be kind of like, you know, where have they come from? And I think that's why I think bringing in the main story NPCs into the dungeons would lead to this being a much, much more immersive experience in the way that Final Fantasy 14 has been able to achieve it. And this has a few potential implications for the game. I feel like Blizzard has always been mindful of having solo players in the game. You know, one of the big differences I noticed between WoW leveling and Final Fantasy 14 leveling, and one that really irritated me in 14, is that the WoW dungeon quests are almost always optional. You know, you can just ignore the quest, continue on without doing it, and you know, sometimes you'll miss the end of a story, but generally, even there, they do seem to try and put the effort into, you know, still having the story make sense, and they don't always succeed, but most of the time it kind of works out. Now, personally, I found the forced dungeons of 14 really annoying, particularly as with 14, I only really wanted to do the story because the max level gameplay, the way the classes work, never really landed for me. Now, because Blizzard obviously have to do that, they do have to adapt their story so that they don't leave a massive hole. Now, while they usually do a decent job of that, there are obviously exceptions. You know, the Westfall story in Cataclysm, Vanessa there, her story is just completely incomplete if you don't do the Dead Mines. But that's, I do think that's a kind of rare exception. But the fact that they have to do that does affect how they build the story and make it flow. And as we all know, in World of Warcraft, the story does sometimes have some pacing and flow issues. And that is probably one of the contributing factors to that. Now, if we remove this requirement where you have to skip dungeons because you can't solo them, I think that might make Blizzard a bit more comfortable of not making them an option and trying to use them more fully as part of the story. Because, you know, if the solo players can just do it as a follower dungeon, there's not really much of a penalty there for, you know, making them compulsory. And that, I think, could be quite interesting for how Blizzard deliver their story. Now, we don't know at this stage if the Fallout dungeons are going to be carried forward into future expansions. The devs were pretty open that the chances of the system carrying forward would depend on the reception of the feature and how well it was received. Now, I personally think that the feature has been very well received indeed, but the participation in it is a bit of a mystery because, you know, the vocal end of the player base, I think, are the real market for this feature, especially late in the expansion. And so the ones who are likely to be playing it are probably people who are not talking about it much, but I'm sure Blizzard are going to have some internal data to help inform that. Assuming that this feature does do well enough, then I think it could become a very useful tool to help the developers improve the flow and the pacing of the story, especially later in expansions, which is something that they do seem to struggle with quite a bit. There's a good example of this struggle in patch 10.1.0. The main story of the patch rightly got quite a bit of disappointed to negative feedback from players, mainly, in my opinion, due to the characterisation of Wrathy and Sibellium. In the patch, it felt to me like the team were trying to depict the impact of Old God Whispers on the characters, but this didn't really come across very clearly in-game. That was especially the case for the way that they just seemed to miraculously and suddenly recover and improve for no apparent reason in the storyline that came after the raid opened up. I think the player reaction there was, what's up with this? What just happened there? What changed? Now, this gap, I think, is due to a bit of the story being inside the raid. You know, when we go in the raid, we encounter an echo of Notharion and a vision of Notharion, who spends quite a bit of time taunting and goading Wrathian and Sibellium. And it's only once they stand up to him near the end of the raid that this vision is revealed as an old god minion, a faceless one. Now, it's never really explained in-game, so I could be wrong about this, but what I got away from that is that the Faceless was probably the source of the Whispers, and after we as characters defeat it, it frees our dragon friends from the Whispers and allows them to recover. But I think because that was in the raid, and because, you know, we're all busy raiding and not paying attention to it, and a lot of players, you know, haven't even seen it, I think it means that for most of the player base, we completely missed that bit of the narrative. The end result of that was, well, honestly, that whole narrative arc just, I think, felt incoherent to a lot of us. Now, this issue of like group content making it hard for us to follow the story, I think is even worse with a raid. You know, once you scale up to like 20 odd people, you've even more pressure on you, you've even more noise. You're just not going to see what's going on inside the raid. It's kind of a shame Blizzard put all this effort into character dialogue, and I suspect more than half of us don't even pay any attention to it. Now, obviously, we're not going to get a follower raid. I don't think the technology could scale up to those numbers, but I do think that they should consider putting an option in for a scenario-based follower run-through of the raid space which covers the story. In fact, for a low-engaged player like me, I would personally love that the week before the raid opens, I could run through that space and encounter the story of the adventure that, you know, we're doing in the raid with a few of the relevant NPCs. And then when I go into the raid the week after, that could just become us as players reliving that space, reliving those fights, but on that more epic scale. Now, many raid bosses in raids often to me feel a bit contrived lore-wise. Let's be honest, if you have to have 10 bosses in a raid, you can't let the story dictate all of the enemies. That's just the reality that I think the dev team face. So simply by letting us fight the same bosses that we just saw in this scenario, I think would also be a bit meh. So I think that they could still be able to add more bosses and more epic encounters into the raid, but without trying to force them into the story. My idea being, you know, you could maybe have 3 or 4 of the like bosses be story related, and then the extra bosses that they're having to force in anyway, you could just make them be like tangential to the story, or perhaps, you know, minions of some of the big boss. And I think that would allow them to pull the story off a lot more cleanly. You know, and the scenario potentially could just have, you know, story specific enemies, and the raid can then just be, you know, go and fight stuff that, you know, meets the flavor of the raid. Now, the one issue I think here would be that the end boss of the raid is really always going to be the main story protagonist, and I've a feeling you probably perhaps wouldn't want us to be able to go in story mode and just wipe the boss out even before the raid opens. So I think most likely there would need to be a bit of time gating there, where maybe the scenario version was split over a couple of weeks so that you could reach that boss in the scenario version after the raid's been opened. Now, we don't like time gating, honestly, but this is probably a place where pragmatically it would make sense. And the benefit of this, you know, for non-raiders is, you know, they can just go in maybe week two of the raid, you know, after which, you know, all the big boys have kind of cleared out the raid, and you can just go in and we can experience the story, and hopefully told in a better way than raiding does. And I genuinely don't think this will be bad for raiding players, because honestly, am I going to not go into my normal or heroic raid with my guild because I've already seen the story? No, I'm going to go in and do it anyway, because the reality is I've already seen the story. I've heard the descriptions. I've watched all the cinematics. So yeah, I think this is genuinely a bit of a non-issue, but it would allow, if they went this way, allow them to tell the story better, while also allowing this to still keep the epic raid encounters and potentially even amp up the raid a little bit. You know, if they don't have to make every single boss fit the story, would that give them some more options to be a bit more innovative or interesting about the bosses? Well, that's the story side of the feature, but that's not the whole story. Okay, sorry, no more puns. Yeah, I'll stop. Story by its nature is generally not very repeatable. You know, once you know the story, you know it. And while I know a lot of people like to reread books or watch reruns on TV, there's a lot of people who, like me, rarely reread books or rewatches TV shows. I mean, I kind of, once I know the story, I kind of just generally find it boring to do it again. But even if you do want to relive it, there's a limit, right, to how many times you want to do that before it gets too much. I've got 30 alts at level 70 right now, and frankly, after having got them all there, I'm totally done with the Dragonflight leveling zones. Like, I won't want to go anywhere near them for at least a good couple of expansions. But, you know, the heart of an MMO is all about repeatable content and gameplay. You know, my guild, we rerun the raid pretty much weekly for entire seasons, and God knows how many Waycrests I've done in Season 3 by now. But honestly, when it comes to world content players, repeatable content is severely lacking. You know, I do quite a bit of world content, and, you know, doing the same old few old world quests is just that it's not interesting after a couple of weeks. Now, I'm actually going to do a bit of a separate video about that at some point, because I actually think a lot of the world content they've been doing since 9.2 has a lot of innovation in it, but it's still quite lacking in depth. So overall, yeah, world content, it's not just not really not replayable enough at the moment, and I do wonder if this feature might give them another lever they could pull to get a bit more replayable content out for the players who want to play that type of content. Now, we have seen Blizzard try to do this in the past. I think Island Expeditions, Warfronts, Horrific Visions, Torghast, and now even the public events have all been attempts to solve that. Now, many of those alternatives have had their own issue. I think Island Expeditions, Warfronts, and especially Torghast had poor reward design, which made them feel forced onto players who didn't really want or need them. Because, you know, I personally, Torghast's a really good example. I thought the gameplay potential in Torghast was awesome, but that pressure to have to do the maximum, you know, as soon as you possibly can to max out your progress toward the legendary just completely soured it from me. In fact, in many ways, for quite a bit of this content, it really felt like that there was really good ideas trying to get out if only Blizzard would let them come out. Now, in the War Within, we're going to have Delves, which will be like the new version of this type of content. Now, it's got a lot of interest just now because the team are saying the right things, but You know, if I look back to BFA, I remember the excitement pre-launch about island expeditions. I remember the excitement about Torghast. So, you know, being excited about content we haven't seen, I think we know that it doesn't always pan out. Sometimes it does, but often it doesn't. And if Delves don't pan out, where's that going to leave WoW content? Is it just going to be back to WoW quests and the same old, same old? I think the reality is what we know from BFA and Shadowlands is that this type of content is really hard to do well, and it can be very difficult to get it to land with players. And if you have a miss, it can have a very devastating impact in the game, right? If you ask people right at the start of BFA what was wrong with the game, they would point to island expeditions and warfronts. And when you talk about Shadowlands, well, there's a big long list of what went wrong there. But Torghast is most definitely one of the ones that's up there. Now, I'd like to think the team have likely learned enough that they could avoid making the Delves feel forced for all players. But, you know, even then, if the content doesn't land and it's optional, it just becomes dead content. And then what do players do then? Now, one thing we do know is that the group-oriented players do find both dungeon and raid content to be very repeatable. And with this tech, it opens up the ability that Blizzard could potentially start to use the dungeon content to try and satisfy that one third to two thirds of player who just don't want to do group content. Now, I don't think that a normal dungeon will really cut it for that. The problem is that normal dungeons right now drop worse loot than the normal raid gear that you can often get from other sources of WoW content. And in The War Within, they've suggested that the Delves will, like Warfronts did in BFA, give heroic raid gear. Now, gear progression is a core part of a vertical MMO like WoW, and the gameplay's just not in it on its own enough to make for truly repeatable content. I mean, sure, the people at the very high levels of Mythic Plus do find it repeatable, even though they don't get better gear. But even there, you know, they're chasing a score. You always need some kind of goal to chase to make it interesting. And the reality of World of Warcraft is that for a lot of players, the goal is to get better gear. So what if, as well as the normal follower dungeons, there was a mode which integrated the dungeons more into the Delve system? For example, could you reuse the dungeon interiors and the bosses to expand the pool of content for Delves? Or could you just, you know, make the dungeons be a slightly different type of Delve, you know, get a bit more content, a bit more variety and depth into the gameplay? And what then if we could expand it to be bits of the raid interior? Could you just say like an LFR wing as a Delve? Now, this would require an independent gearing system that integrated with the other world content gear systems, so that they don't, you know, as the current follower dungeons are, just be completely uninteresting but get better gear sources. But also, you know, there's the challenge of avoiding cannibalizing into Mythic Plus or higher end raid progress as well. Now, is this possible? Well, I actually think it is. In most modern expansions these days, you can get normal level gear from the open world at quite a decent rate, and from what I've seen, it hasn't stopped people from raiding. And, you know, back off in BFA, Warfronts did give heroic gear, and that didn't kill off heroic raiding, nor indeed did Horrific Visions, which actually went as far as to offer mythic level gear. If you don't remember, if you did a 5-mask run on in a Horrific Vision, you could once a week get a piece of Mythic Plus 15 gear, which was as good as mythic raid gear. So, while I think there is a lot of worry and fear around the potential that, you know, content like this, especially if it gave good gear, could cannibalize group content, and yet there will be some players that would choose to go solo at that point, I think the evidence we've seen from other times when Blizzard have got close is that it's not as cannibalistic as you would think it would be. I think, in truth, a lot of people like doing the group content, especially if it's like faster or a more efficient source of getting that better gear. And the truth in my view is that, you know, obviously, you know, if the solo system is easy and faster to get gear, you're going to have a big chunk of players that are going to feel forced to do it. And we've seen that repeatedly. We saw it in BFA, we saw it in Shadowland, but where things are equal or a little bit slower, all the indications are that most players will choose to do what's fun for them. The solo players will enjoy playing solo content, the group players will continue to enjoy playing group content, and they'll probably have a happier time of it, because especially if you're pug and you're doing group content, some of those people that you encounter, honestly, and we've all seen it, those people don't really want to be there, and if they had other content to do, maybe they wouldn't be, and maybe the quality of our pugs would go up. Now, with the PvP role in the vault being replaced with a world content sort of casual play sort of role, I think this does provide a good vehicle they could use to pace those better rewards down. You know, currently, you know, most PvP players live without filling that third role. Outside of the race for world first contenders who do, I believe, push those roles the first couple of weeks. But I think most people agree you shouldn't be building what is a mass market game around those folks. So let's set them to a side at the moment. I feel that, like, you know, the slower pace of follower dungeons, which basically means the cost of doing them solo essentially becomes time, would probably be enough to make it feel inefficient enough that group players wouldn't really want to do it too much. You know, if I think about myself in a typical evening PlayStation, if I'm wanting to like fill out my mythic dungeon roll, I can do like 4 mythic pluses in a night. If I was doing those as follower dungeons, I'm maybe only going to go 2 or 3, which means I've not managed to fill 2 slots then. So what am I going to do? Am I going to do the follow dungeon? Am I going to do the group mythic plus? I'm going to do the group mythic plus because I don't want to have to spend another night on it, you know. In the real world, most of us, we don't have time for that. Let's be face it. And I do, now, there will be an undeniable benefit to opening up more rows, more options. Some people who do group content, again, race to world first was, probably would do it because, you know, you want those extra slots, but I'm just not convinced that it would be that cannibalistic. I think the truth is that a lot of the fear of cannibalism is almost like that human reaction that you're worried you'll lose something because it's changing. I think, honestly, you know, we'd still have plenty of people doing Mythic Plus. There would be less people, but the less people are probably the people that we don't want to really play with. I'll take all comers on a Mythic Plus as long as we can complete it, but somebody who doesn't want to be there, it's, you can feel it, you can tell, it's just not as good as an experience. I actually think it would be good for us. Now, all of this will be risky. If Blizzard do get the gearing wrong and make it faster and more efficient, it's going to be next to impossible to slow it down once it gets going. So, yeah, you could get back into another Warfront situation and sort of another like island expedition thing where people feel we have to do it even though we don't want to. So I think probably the right thing for Blizzard would be to start slow, to probably start with things like follower dungeons being limited to normal level gear, maybe limit it, make it really slow, kind of like the Warfronts. One of the reasons I think we got away with the Warfronts was you only really got a piece of heroic gear every 3 weeks, which is really, really slow compared to Mythic Plus or raiding. And then potentially, you know, gradually over time, they could kind of ramp it up as they do the benefits of that. Now, there is one, I think, final question to all of this. I think to justify, you know, giving players who are not doing raiding Mythic Plus, you know, Mythic level gear, it has to be a suitable challenge, right? You wouldn't want to, say, give somebody who is doing something as difficult as like a heroic dungeon or a Mythic Zero dungeon, like full on end of mythic raid boss dungeon gear. So you would have to ramp the content up, and you're getting then into the level of like mage tower sort of level of difficulty, and that does raise the question how many of the solo or world content players really want that content. I actually think that's a really interesting question. You know, those five mask horrific vision runs did offer gear of this quality, but only Blizzard are going to know how popular they were to do, and or how many people just did a couple to get them out and left it at that. My own experience back there was I didn't hear an awful lot of people from Raid or other people I know talk about them, so maybe they didn't, and maybe that's the thing that Blizzard know that we don't, that, you know, that particular group of players just wouldn't want it. But overall, for me, you know, I think the big benefit of going down a route where, you know, suitably hard follower dungeons or suitably hard things like delves could give the best gear would just, it's expanding the pool of available content for non-big three players, and that's something I think that's sorely needed. You know, but the benefit of follower dungeons is it reduces the amount of extra stuff the devs need to develop. You know, they're reusing spaces and bosses, and that frees them up to do, well, you know, even more content. Now, I'm going to acknowledge straight away that there will be some impact for the big three. There are without doubt players right now who are forcing themselves through Mythic Plus or who are paying for carries that would move away from it, but I genuinely believe the majority of players, at least the players who like the big three content, they will stay with it. And as I've already said, you know, when you're pugging with somebody who doesn't want to do the content, it just doesn't make a great experience for everyone else. And you know, as for less boosting, yeah, sure, that's going to be bad for boosters. You know, boosting, without a doubt though, does drive negative activities like RMT and botting. We have to face that up. You know, that's just a reality. Even if a lot of boosting is just, you know, the guy who like farms mats getting a lot of gold and saying, oh, I'll spend it in curve. You know, people bot and do RMT for a reason, and I suspect boosting is part of it. Now, if access to gold does become a major issue for top guilds, and you know, I totally get that, the players who do sales runs, some of them don't want to do other guild making activities, but you know, that's something Blizzard can easily fix. They can reduce repair costs, they can, you know, increase the amount of gold you get from like dungeon bosses. You know, if we're solo players are getting equal gear to what like you can get from a Mythic Plus 20, why shouldn't a player in a Mythic Plus 20 get equal gold to what a player that does world quests does at the end of the day? Now, Blizzard often do try to stand their ground in this stuff. I think they do want it to be an MMO. They do want us to have to worry about the gold and stuff like that if we only raid, but you know, Blizzard also clearly do like the prestige that comes with the esport elements of the game. If they start to see the very big guilds starting to stumble or close down because of the gold issue, they're going to act. Trust me, they would fix this. So that's my thoughts for where they could go with follower dungeons. But what about you? Do you think they should lean harder into follower dungeons and giving us better rewards? Or do you worry that that could be the death knell for group content? Let me know in the comments below. Now, if you found this video interesting, do please also let me know by hitting the like icon. That also lets YouTube know that it's worth sharing this video a bit more widely than they might otherwise do. And if you'd like to support my channel by getting notified when my next video goes live, do hit the subscribe icon and the bell notification down below. I'll be back with more news, views, and reviews about World of Warcraft very soon, but that's all for now. Hopefully, I will see you again.